Support for Lab Out Loud is brought to you by the National Science Teachers Association. Find out more at nsta.org. You're listening to the Lab Out Loud podcast, Science for the Classroom and Beyond. And today we're looking at toys, STEM toys.
There's some really great companies who are testing these toys and with parents and kids who are developing them with educators or curriculum writers that understand educational value. And they're providing guides for parents or for the kids, depending on their age. Or they're explaining to parents what STEM is and giving them ideas and questions to ask their kids to allow them to be the ones to discover. That's when you know you have a positive toy in your hand.
That's up next on Lab Out Loud. But first, I'm your co-host, Dale Basler.
And I'm Brian Bartel. That's right. This is the toy episode.
Like, it's the toy episode like we've had.
It is the
previous
We haven't had a toy episode. We had a Halloween episode.
Oh, I see where you're going with that. We have had episodes about toys before, but you're framing
like one
this
toy.
As the toy episode, like the toy section.
Yeah. So a few weeks ago, I was working with a teacher or a couple of teachers, and they were basically, you know, saying like, man, Christmas at the Bartel household must be fun. You gotta think about all the STEM toys coming out under the tree there.
Ah.
And, you know, and that does happen now. Absolutely. But, you know, I thought, you know, we haven't had how do you review STEM toys and know if they're legit or not? Or how do you know if this is actually like learning happening, or is a toy just riding the STEM wave?
For sure. There are, you know, one can imagine toys that are doing it really good for STEM and ones that are probably not so good.
Yeah. So we've certainly seen examples of toys that really do help children to learn STEM skills or concepts or vocabulary that are related to STEM. My name is Monica Cardella, and I am the director of Inspire. I am also an associate professor of engineering education at Purdue University. So that means that I do research on how children learn engineering, and I also teach undergraduate engineering courses.
One of the things that I've been thinking about is, are there really STEM toys? Are there STEM-like toys? They kind of masquerade as STEM, but are they really STEM toys?
We certainly also have seen some cases of toys that may be labeled STEM, but might not live up to that label. One of the things we think about, too, is it really STEM, or is it just science, or just math, or just engineering?
Okay.
So when we think about STEM, we're usually trying to look for more than just one of those four STEM disciplines, but actually some blend of those things.
How do you evaluate that?
Well, we have something called an engineering gift guide. My name is Elizabeth Gajic, and I'm the Assistant Director for INSPIRE, a research institute for pre-college engineering in the School of Engineering Education at Purdue University. I'm a former math teacher and district specialist, and I've been here at Purdue for 9 years. So each year, we've developed some rubrics that we evaluate the toys using the rubric. And so what we do is we're kind of looking at, okay, is it teaching a math or science concept? And then are they then applying that to solve a problem? Or are they specifically talking about what role the scientist is playing, what role the engineering is playing, and how they work together to solve a problem? And there's several toys out there that do a really good job of those things. And so we work with undergraduate students from Purdue, and we train them in how to look for those things. But then we also ask for input from the larger community, so different students, faculty, staff, community members who have STEM backgrounds, so that we're not making decisions based on our own opinions, but really getting a lot of different input from people about whether these toys do help kids learn STEM skills or not.
As well as we're asking kids, do they also enjoy them? Because that's part of the thing. You can have the best, most educational toy ever, but if kids don't think it's fun and they're not going to play with it or read the book, then why buy it? And so then the other thing is asking parents, you know, some of these toys can be expensive, but some of them are not. Do they find it valuable? So like what they're getting, is it worth that cost? And so, and do they feel like it's engaging for them and their child to interact together? Because we think those are important as well.
Sure. That co-viewing kind of piece or participation piece. Absolutely. So do you have like undergraduate classes that like, oh yeah, we're going to take the toy class?
There are some toy classes, but our particular group doesn't have a toy class. We have very extensive training that when students come work for me each year, they go through the training so that they know what they're doing. And then they use, like I said, rubrics to help them think through the process and to evaluate the toys. And that's basically how we work. And then we'd use the feedback from all the different groups to then write full reviews so that people can go on and read why they got into our guide.
I think about our audience as science teachers. They may be in their 30s or 40s, 50s, 60s. is there a, you know, these toys sometimes wind up in the classroom. Is there a kind of like a, you know, the toy that we all look back on that is kind of like the gold standard of a STEM toy?
So I do comment, not necessarily ask teachers.
Might be an opinionated question, I suppose. Huh? A loaded question.
It is because, okay. But I will tell you that I do ask commonly the undergrads when we're testing with them, like, what toys did you play with that really inspired you to want to pursue your STEM field or engineering in particular? And so one of the toys that I think of as a good STEM toy is Snap Circuits. It's a toy that's been out for a while. It really does help with.
Did you say Snap Circuits?
Oh, yeah, Snap Circuits.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so because of teaching with the circuits, also I think kids can use what they learn through the builds that they're provided about, like, they can use those ideas to make their own builds. And then the neat thing is that it's very easy to troubleshoot because they can see, oh, that light did not turn on. Oh, the fan's not turning, you know, not spinning. Something is wrong. And what do I know about circuits that need to be true? And then kind of going back and checking those things. So, I mean, that's kind of a classic idea of one. Do you have another one, Monica?
So the other thing that comes to my mind is all the building, creating things types of toys. And so one of the ones that we have on our list this year is called Flexi Sticks. But, people may have played with other similar toys, whether it's Lincoln Logs or Tinker Toys or whatnot. But just those ideas, trying to create something where you have kind of unlimited options of what you might create. You can use your imagination, but you're also experimenting and learning about some physics and gravity and those types of things too, as you're seeing what's going to stand up, what's going to fall over. Flexi Sticks is one we have in the guide this year. Tinker Toys is the one that I grew up on as a kid. But they're pretty similar ideas of just being able to put together different pieces that are different shapes and sizes. And so you're learning a little bit about which things will work together, which things maybe won't work together. How it's a little bit of abstraction, really, of how do you take this idea in your mind of this thing you want to create, and then you have to do some abstraction to use the pieces that you have to actually make it. Abstraction is something that we've been thinking a lot about as we've been thinking about not just STEM, but also computational thinking.
Mm-hmm. So what about expense? Because we've seen a lot of robotic toys come out on the market, and I'm a fan of many of them, like the Sphero, for instance. We just did an episode talking about the Sphero and then its spinoff company, Misty, too. But those are really, in a sense, higher end toys. Can we get some good STEM learning out of, you know, more affordable kind of options?
Absolutely. Yeah. So in our gift guide, we tried to be sensitive to the range of budgets that different families or different people have. So in the gift guide, there's some that are more in the $10 to $15 range, but then sure, there are some that are more $100, $200. The Flexi Sticks I was talking about, that's one where you can get a kit for about $15. There's some slightly more advanced kits that are a little bit more than that. One of my personal favorites I actually just bought my dad for a Christmas present what is it called? It's Asteroid Escape. Mm-hmm. And so it's more of a logic-based puzzle. But you have these different spacecraft that you're moving around to try and get them to avoid the different moons or whatnot, asteroids, to be able to get out. It's similar to the Rush Hour. Maybe you've seen that one before, but one of those kind of logic puzzle games. But really beautiful pieces, really durable, lots and lots and lots of different levels. So you have lots of different challenges, and only $15.
Yeah. So is durability into your evaluation there as well? Because we know that there's, as educators, we see this a lot too. We see kits that are purchased that, you know, they're supposed to last for 10 years, but, you know, we barely get through the first year without breakage.
Yes. And like you said, I think some toys, they make it into the teacher's classroom and they're not necessarily made for teacher's classrooms. Do you know what I mean?
No.
And so sometimes those don't necessarily last as well because they're really made for, for a parent and a child. So like a common one is Learning Resources Robot Mouse. You know, it's such a great resource. It's such a good price range. You know, it's less than $100, less than $50 to get the whole kit. And so a lot of teachers are using that, but some issues can be that, you know, kids can drag the mouse and can make the gears strip out. And so that's unfortunate, but I think a lot of teachers think it's worth it because it is such a neat tool that's very motivating for kids. It's not too expensive. Like you said, a lot of the other toys are well over $100 or even all the way up to $300-$400 for just one to bring into their classroom.
Mm-hmm.
But we've seen that companies are also bringing some of those ideas into more of a game board. So not necessarily using a screen. Things like this year, we saw that Learning Resources brought Code and Go Mouse Mania board game. And a lot of the kids really liked that board game just as much as they liked using the robot mouse. They had cute little figures that they could move around on the board. They had still to use coding. And it was a fun, exciting game that they really liked doing. And it's great for younger kids that maybe don't have as much screen coding already happening at school.
Are there certain topics that are subject matters in science that are favored? I think there are, like your engineering, your circuits, your building, and those kinds of things where maybe something like earth science is harder to hit, or maybe something like biology in terms of like growing things. Do you see like there's an area that...
You don't see yet do it yourself CRISPR kits yet.
Yeah, like, is there an area for growth that is like, oh, there's nothing in this area? Like, come on.
Yeah, I think, I mean, we should acknowledge that we do have some bias because we are engineering education. So engineering is our focus. So
sure.
It might be partially our bias. One thing that we've seen a big change in this year is books, where in the past there just weren't very many good, especially fiction books for kids that related to STEM, especially engineering. But this year we've seen a lot more of those.
Yes, you have a section on that. Do you do that every year, or you just were able to do it better this year?
We do it every year, and I think that we're... Like, again, we're truly focusing on engineering integrated with STEM. And so I think that this year there just happened to be a lot more books on those particular topics. And I've already seen a lot more new ones come out since we kind of finished the guide. So I'm excited for next year.
Okay.
So I think that people are realizing that kids want to read about STEM, that it's like one of my favorite things to do is to pair a book with a toy. So like, for example, one of my favorite books is Curiosity, the Story of a Mars Rover. And there's a really cool Thames and Cosmos rover kit. And so, you know, your kids can learn about this instance where, you know, scientists and engineers work together to develop this this rover to go to Mars. And what does it do? And then they could go, you know, learn about constructing a rover that they can test out in code with a toy. And so then it kind of encourages their imagination and also might encourage other learning that they might want to do at the library or to get more books.
I really like that because I even see my own son like watching, you know, like a Marvel movie, and then he's going to replicate that in his Legos, for instance. And so, or we watched when we watched Star Wars, where BB-8 was driving, you know, he was in one of the walkers with the top off, and he tried to build that. It was just, you know, that kind of like streams that a story into other areas of imagination as well.
Yeah. And I think the other cool thing is that people are starting to get realize that there's these really cool programs, like, for example, Scratch Junior, that does a really good job of teaching kids coding, and it's a free app, but a lot of times parents are a little intimidated by not being able to really understand it. And so we have a great book that Edburn just put out that's my first computer coding book using Scratch Junior, and it has really great pictures and illustrations to really help parents and kids feel very excited about going in and not being intimidated to try out coding. It's a wonderful app. We've actually used Scratch Junior in a lot of kindergarten, first and second grade classrooms that we work with, and kids just jump in and are able to do some amazing things with that program. And so I was excited to see that book so that more families will go ahead and try that really neat app.
Sometimes Dale and I work with teachers with using technology, and we encourage Scratch. Sometimes it's fantastic to watch the kids just take off with Scratch, and having that teacher not know a lot, it kind of removes the boundaries that kids can do. Like then the kids show the teacher what they can do versus we're all going to sit down and we're going to do the same thing. It's kind of interesting when that is reversed.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Are there like colossal flops? I don't want you to name names, but are there things that like when we work in ed tech, and Brian, I think, coined the term ed tech smog, where it's just kind of like it looks good, but it's just kind of filling the air there and actually could be doing some damage. Are there some like big watch out fors in these STEM toys?
I'm going to kind of reverse it just because that's the biggest question here. But I think things to look for so you don't get those flops are like there's some really great companies who are testing these toys and with parents and kids who are developing them with educators or curriculum writers that understand the educational value, and they're providing guides for parents or for the kids, depending on their age, inside. And when they're tying that, whatever the toy is, actually to the science, or they're explaining to parents what STEM is and giving them ideas and questions to ask their kids to allow them to be the ones to discover, that's when you know you have a positive toy in your hand. I think when they're just putting STEM on there to sell something, like if it's a bouncy ball and it says STEM because it's a bouncy ball and they want, you know, I mean, I think you can put STEM on anything. Oh, that uses test gravity or, you know, like whatever they happen to put on it. I think you just got to be careful about, you know, the trusted companies out there, and then also figuring out, looking inside and seeing, do they have those guides for parents or for kids to give them that guidance?
And it reminds me of Standards Aligned too. Standards Aligned is another comment where it gets kind of slapped on a lot of things, and they get assessed and they're like, they're not standards aligned at all, or they're not NGSS aligned.
They're just mentioning NGSS, and you can't throw a sticker on it. But
I think one of the neat things is that there is a group that STEM.org, I think it's called, that it's a company that a lot of these STEM companies, to be able to stand out, to say, yes, we really did test and think about this, they're going to get certified through that particular program. And so that's kind of neat that they're giving that particular type of certification on the STEM toys like that.
Okay.
So they're putting that time into the curriculum connections. They're showing you that it's been done, if you can kind of see it in action. Thinking about the durability, appropriate price. Is there something else we're missing that we should be watching out for? Watching for? Seeking out?
I mean, I think we think the ideal toys are always the ones that possibly provide a client. There's several like particular logic toys where maybe it's giving us a Goldilocks and Three Bears or Snow White or something like that. They're giving a client, and they're giving you kind of this context in which kids are then solving problems. We think those are really great. Again, like Monica said, building blocks, some of those building blocks, classic toys don't necessarily give you that, but give you the freedom to do those things. We like when they're giving contexts that are that girls and boys both are interesting and want to solve. I think that really causes them to be more engaged when they have a really exciting context.
So with the context and with the girls especially, we're really concerned about that, partially because some of the research we've done, there seems to be a pattern of people buying STEM-related toys for boys about twice as frequently as they do for girls.
Sure.
So we're really concerned about this. And so some of the contexts that are related to helping someone or helping the environment or some kind of, you know, social good, those kind of connections, some other research suggests are really great for engaging girls.
Yeah. I'm looking at the document, and I know Dale doesn't have it in front of him, but on page 5, there is a section on troubleshooting and why it's so important. And I'm going to use it in other areas, so just so you know. But there's you have it broken down for observing, diagnosing, explaining, and fixing, and it gives parents tips, like if a child gets stuck, ask questions and provide suggestions, but resist taking over. I might just kind of like, you know, sneak this on a teacher's desk here or there. And but I get caught in that myself, actually, too. It is easy to just do it and come in and take over when we do recognize a lot of really good learning comes from the troubleshooting itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we're hoping that that, you know, kids as well as parents, educators are thinking about troubleshooting kind of in, as you mentioned, in a variety of ways and hopefully in a systematic way, too, where it's not just trial and error, but something more thoughtful, you know, as you were saying in the article, observing and then diagnosing what the problem is and then trying to explain what's going on rather than just try something, did it work until it finally works. But again, just be a little more thoughtful about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love the layout there. I love the explanation there. And I think it can be useful in a variety of different methods there. I almost am wondering, do we have toys out there that are intentionally broken and the whole purpose is to fix them and, you know, make them work, like, you know, broken robot and fix it?
Well, I've seen stuff like people talk about the kid. I think it was Sid. He was the bad kid in Toy Story. But he he was remixing the toys, and some people are like, he's a little maker.
So there, I don't know of any toys that are broken, but I do know like the Tinker Kiwi crates. The nice thing about those is that they do give the kids a design of maybe like, for example, one of the ones we got this year was a hydraulic claw. And so it's an okay design. It works. But then they teach the kids all these different science activities, and then they use what they learn to make improvements. And so then they use that and they make it even better to do like whatever the goal is in the end. So I think that there are these toys where they're like, hey, we're going to give you some ideas and designs. Now learn the science and then you can apply it and make it even better and accomplish a goal.
Okay. Before we let you go, I'm thinking about this in the context of schools and science teachers and even maybe maker spaces. In our earlier conversation, you mentioned that some of these toys are really designed for like a one-on-one experience with the parent co-viewing step there. But we're starting to see the popularity of maker spaces where we might want to get 30 of, you know, Ozobots or 30 of Lego kits. And is that really appropriate in those scenarios? Or what advice would you have for teachers in trying to implement some of these toys in the classroom?
I think the first thing that comes to my mind is maybe not 30 of the exact same toy, but to get some variety, just because some toys will appeal more to some kids than others. And at the same time, we know that some toys support some skills while other ones support different skills. So if teachers were able to get a variety of things, maybe choose four different things and then get seven or eight of each of those four, so that kids can both rotate through those toys, but also just be able to make some choices about what's interesting to them.
And I think that as teachers are investing in these things, that they need to look at how versatile each of the toys are, and is it worth the cost? Because some of the, for example, the coding toys that can be very expensive, they can only be used one certain way, whereas other toys can you use Blockly and then use more advanced coding. So really thinking about, you know, can this toy grow with my students? Are my advanced students going to get as much out of it as my other student, you know, as other students? Can I make modifications so that all students are involved and excited about what we're doing? And there are, even in building toys, there's several toys, like one of our favorites last year, the electric motor catalyst STEM kit. It had multiple challenges that kids could approach it so many different ways. And depending on what team you're on or whatever you're working on, you can use those particular pieces in multiple ways. So I think if teachers are really thinking about those solid pieces, like you said, that aren't going to be destructed in 5 seconds, and that can be used, that if a kit can be used in multiple ways, then I think that's worth the investment in a classroom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So in our gift guide, we do have some labels to let people know what specific skills the different toys are teaching. So that's yes. One thing we wanted to do to help people.
Logical
to be able
thinking,
to,
like, perseverance, yeah, problem solving. Yep.
The other thing I'll say is another one of ours from last year is another one of the robots. This one's Cosmo.
Yes.
That one, we've done some work and just developed some additional activities that people can do using that robot. And in partnering with one of our local science museums too, we've seen a lot of things you can do with that one too.
Cool. Now I just want to go. I'm looking at the document. It's like a toy catalog. Like, oh yeah, I want to dive in here. And I already bought Christmas catalogs. Presents for my kids. Maybe we'll have to add a couple more.
Yeah, maybe you just get your own, Brian, and don't tell anyone.
Well, sometimes I do, and I can call it job related. So, shh.
Absolutely. Oh yes.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Monica and Elizabeth. It's been fun, and we look forward to seeing the STEM toys in the next year.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks much. If you'd like to learn more about today's episode, head on over to our website, laboutloud.com, for more information. You can also find details about all the previous episodes, and you can leave us feedback and comments. We want to hear from you.
If you enjoyed the show, make sure you've subscribed on iTunes, Google Play Music, or your favorite podcasting platform. And if you really enjoyed it, consider leaving us a rating or a review. Your feedback helps others find our show.
If you like Lab Out Loud and you love the show that we provide for you, please consider supporting the show at our Patreon page. Head on over to patreon.com/laboutloud for more information. Until next time, I'm Dale Basler.
And I'm Brian Bartel.